Welcome to the second episode of CBH. Today we're going to briefly touch upon the 1957 Atlas Implosion's effect on Marvel Silver Age leading up to the 1968 acquisition of Marvel by Perfect Film. This talk also includes how to interpret the logos that are present on the covers during this time period. Now, this talk will also include some of the interesting creators along the way. Now, Martin Goodman Comics, later known as Marvel, had an Atlas logo which represented Goodman's distribution company, not the actual comic book line. In 1957, Martin Goodman closed Atlas Distribution to use the cheaper American News Distribution Company. Unfortunately, American News Distribution subsequently went out of business due to many factors, but one of them was losing Dell Comic Book Company as a client. Goodman realized what a mistake this was and ended up having to use Independent News Distribution instead to distribute his comic books. Independent News Distribution had a logo that said IND on the top of these comics. Now, IND was owned by what was later known as DC Comics, which was Marvel's competition then, just like it is now, and mercilessly limited Goodman from a heavy comic book load to a small fraction of its output to 8 monthly titles and lost 1 to 2 months of publication. Stan Lee, the editor, decided to make it 16 bi-monthly titles instead for diversity and used up inventory of already made comics, and this situation put many artists and writers out of work. This is called the Atlas Implosion. This explains why the Atlas logo, which is present in this Gunsmoke Western comic in August 1957 on the top left, changed to the initials IND in November 1957. Now, IND held this contract until 1968, when both DC and Marvel were bought by larger corporations. Now, as much as these dates, covers, and logos are incredibly interesting, what's also even more interesting is how the people within the company dealt with this hardship and created Marvel's Silver Age. The 1957 Atlas Implosion was incredibly disappointing for editor Stan Lee, who was used to working under a much larger scope, but was now limited to a much smaller output of comic books. But he did have some star artists like Joe Manili and Matt Baker, as well as some inventory to use up. Unfortunately, both died in their 30s, with Joe Manili dying in a train incident in 1958 and Matt Baker dying of a heart attack in 1959. This left a void of star talent, which was soon filled out of basic necessity by Jack Kirby and Steve Ditko. In 1959, Jack Kirby needed some work. Due to a difference in opinion in who gets royalty money out of the Sky Masters newspaper strip between DC editor Jack Schiff and the team of Kirby and the Wood brothers, a lawsuit between the two caused Jack to lose his working assignments over at DC, including his famous Challengers of the Unknown, and he needed a solid paying gig to support his family. He then went to work at Martin Goodman Comics, for whom he co-created Captain America. Steve Ditko was young and experimenting with various surreal styles of artistic storytelling and worked for several companies including Charlton, as well as what was later to be called Marvel Comics. Now, with this new artistic infusion into Martin Goodman's comics company, the Silver Age of Marvel would essentially begin, with help from people like Wally Wood. Now, as Jack Kirby finished his last Sky Master strip in February 1961, he soon thereafter co-creates with Stan Lee Fantastic Four 1, which was cover dated for November 1961. As you can see, there is no Marvel logo here, but the distributor is clearly labeled as Independent News Distribution. Ditko applied his visceral human artistic sense in co-creating Spider-Man in 1961 and Doctor Strange in 1963 with Stan Lee. And with the villains and heroes that Kirby and Ditko co-creates with Stan Lee, the Silver Age Marvel Universe was essentially created. In 1963, Goodman Comics released books to have the Marvel Comics Group Corner Box, which now labels the Martin Goodman Company comics line as Marvel, distinguishing it from the logo of its distributor, IND. So now you have two different logos on the cover. In the letters column of Fantastic Four 18, 1963, Stan Lee writes that the Marvel Corner Box was Steve Ditko's idea. Now, Kirby co-created and penciled an incredible number of comics per month, including this cover date of September 1963, where he worked on 4 complete issues with Stan Lee, including the covers, which is an extraordinary amount of production out of one human being. Now, here is Jack Kirby and Bill Everett's initial Daredevil design for from the cover of issue 1, 1964 on the left. Wally Wood had left Mad Magazine and briefly joined Marvel before 1965. The middle image is Wally Wood's first redesign of the costume from issue 5, which Stan acknowledges on the bottom of the same page shown below that it was Wally Wood's idea to redesign the costume. Then Wood's next and definitive costume redesign from issue 7, which is the Daredevil that we all know and love today. Unfortunately, Wally Wood was unhappy with his working situation at Marvel and left that very same year. Steve Ditko grew unhappy with his situation at Marvel and left in 1966. He has written several essays on what that situation was, and anyone interested should purchase those essays. Here are his last two issues he worked on for 60s Marvel. Now, in 1968, DC was bought by Kinney and Marvel was bought by Perfect Film. During this flux, Goodman pushed the DC-owned Independent News to lift restrictions on the number of comics they'd distribute, and a whole slew of characters suddenly got their own comics in IND, still on the top left until roughly middle of 1969. Now, Marvel's comic book distribution would soon switch to the Perfect Film-owned Curtis Circulation, and with that, the distributor logo would change from IND to CC. At this point, Marvel would print as many comics as Marvel wanted in 1969, which essentially paved the way for the 1970s. As far as what would happen to the original co-creators in the 1960s, we already mentioned that Wally Wood left in 65, Steve Ditko left in 66, and unfortunately Jack Kirby would leave in 1970, again due to being unhappy with his working situation over at Marvel. So who would Marvel use to carry the reins of these characters when these people left, and that person was John Romita Sr.? John Romita Sr. was Marvel's go-to guy when a major artist or co-creator left Marvel in the 1960s. When Wally Wood left, after some disagreements in 1965, John Romita Sr. took over with Daredevil 12. When Steve Ditko left in 1966, then Romita Sr. took over in Spider-Man 39. When Jack Kirby ultimately left Marvel in 1970, then John Romita Sr. again took over in Fantastic Four 103. And here are the first splash pages to those three issues. Each time an artist would then take over from Romita Sr. when he was essentially holding the fort for those issues. So in a sense, the Atlas implosion put enough stress on the comic book line, specifically Stan Lee himself, where with the death of a couple star artists, an unfortunate business deal with Jack Kirby at DC, an expressive Steve Ditko, and a wandering Wally Wood, they all came together in a boiling pot of creativity where there was a sense of giving it all or nothing. Try anything, see what works, we have nothing to lose. Let's do something new, let's see where this goes. Attitude that led to a reliable comic book line and the logos on these covers going from Atlas to IND to Marvel and IND and then Marvel and Curtis Circulation all set up this framework for Marvel's Silver Age and its amazing creators. This has been another episode of CBH. This video is to function as a brief introduction to this time period. There's a lot of details that I didn't go over, but there are so many resources to actually find out a lot of the in-between details, and I highly encourage anyone who watches this video to go and do that. Cheers.